drink for that, huh?
Here, here. Here, here.
That was...
This is Duncan Stroik in Philadelphia at the architectural office of Alvin Holm. So I have these two esteemed gentlemen here who have spent time in the world of architecture and also in the world of the city of brotherly love. And that's who we're here to talk about their lives and what got them interested in architecture and Philadelphia. My first thought is, how did you get interested in architecture?
I grew up in Oak Park in River Forest, Illinois, right outside Chicago, surrounded by Frank Lloyd Wright's work and his enormous reputation. And I played at his tennis club all the time, and you know, I thought this was just the way houses were supposed to look until I got out of Chicago and found that there were other ways for things to be. But so he was my first great inspiration. I gotta say, I never took architecture seriously as a career, though, until very, very much later.
Well, the funny thing is, Frank Lloyd Wright influenced me also. He had an exhibit, I think it was in Gimbel's, and I just happened to be in Gimbel's and saw him being filmed. Wow. For an interview that later was on the local television to advertise. He had his models, you know, the city of the, what's he called? It wasn't the Usonian houses.
Sunflower House?
No, not the house, no, the town.
The town, the city. Usonian city.
Democracy builds or something like that, you know. And, it was fascinating, and this same model upgraded. It was at the Museum of Modern Art a couple of years ago in town, which was funny. But I saw him. Yeah, it was fascinating. Had a lot of chutzpah and everything, you know. And then when I was looking at the brochure, career brochure in my high school, trying to figure out, well, what should I study? You know, what I want to do, I don't know. And I had no guidance, but there's this fascinating handbook or booklet that explained what an architect does and what it's all about and everything. And that was fascinating. So that was enough that was last 2 years of high school, or getting on to the last year of high school. And I applied for Penn and Catholic U, and there's another one in the Midwest, I think it was, so I went to Penn primarily because it was close by.
Mm-hmm. Could live at home.
I could take the trolley car to school or bicycle.
Save a lot of money.
Later, I mostly bicycle.
Why did you end up at the University of Pennsylvania?
Specifically because I had already had 2 years of graduate work at Yale, where Lou Kahn was the reigning genius, and I was under his spell, and I was taught to think he was fabulous by Vincent Scully, who was my favorite teacher at Yale undergraduate, where I studied largely because of Scully, history of architecture.
Scully got you interested in studying with Kahn or studying at Penn?
Well, he got me interested in architecture as, you know, as the kind of the great art, you know. Architects were all
really
universal men, and architecture involved everything. It involved sociology and philosophy and art and painting and sculpture.
Really?
And
he was a great...
It brought everything
inspiration to people.
Yeah.
And to clients. Who were the other teachers and what did you learn
at Penn?
Yeah, in architecture.
Lou was the principal. I mean, he was the reason I came. But then I personally got a lot out of Bob Geddes and G.B. Cusey. And I liked George Qualls.
What were they? What was their emphasis? Geddes and Qualls.
Well, they were all disciples of Lou.
Oh, they were?
Or apparently.
Oh.
Everybody was.
Everybody was a disciple of Lou at Penn by the time you were there.
Yeah. They didn't do things that looked like Lou.
Okay.
But they thought that he was the kind of the spiritual guide.
Oh, interesting.
And they all felt that way. My favorites teachers were, well, Bob Geddes first, because he was a little more of a little broader intellectual orbit than the rest. Not so, he saw more clearly the relationships between buildings and cities and,
really?
And cultures and
okay,
cultures
good.
And, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, very much more philosophical. But Qualls was terrific.
Harvard? Did he come from Harvard?
Gee, I don't know. That would be interesting.
I thought
to know.
He did. But
I wouldn't be surprised.
Now, were there, weren't,
he had a
weren't there
a broader, more liberal
really?
Point of view?
Weren't there in the mid-50s when you were there, Dad? Weren't there still some residue of a somewhat classical training, or was it all gone by the mid-50s?
It's funny. My first mentor, but they're did they call them then? Counselors. Were assigned, everybody that came had an older person, a teacher, and Harry Sternfeld, did you ever run into him? He was a classicist, and he did some, he's most famous for the synagogue that's on Lincoln Avenue, I think it's called, and you can drive up past the park there and stuff, and it's up high right at the end of where the Lincoln Avenue, I think, turns. And it's very dramatic. But anyhow, he, I think, won the Rome Prize back when he was younger and that sort of thing.
Wow.
And they had his drawings there at the library. But the rest of the people...
pretty modernist.
Never
by the
said
time.
Anything about those arts except some of the Harry Sternfeld that taught math. Isn't that right? Or am I mispronouncing his name?
I remember.
He wrote a bunch of books.
But I never met him.
That.
When were you there?
I graduated in '58. And I started in '52, and I took a year off, and I worked at the Planning Commission under Ed Bacon in Willow Van Malky.
And then Alvin Holm, when were you there?
Just 60 to 62.
60 to 62, right.
Yeah.
So just right after. So
there was no residue of classical.
There wasn't. Okay. What about drawing, though? Weren't you taught some drawing skills and life drawing? Were you taught any of that kind of thing?
Not a pen.
No.
We were taught how to draw by an older person. It might have been Harry, whatever his name is.
Sternfeld.
I
thought there was a woman involved.
Stash Nowitzki?
Well, that was first year. Well, there we learned the basics.
Yeah.
But it was Beaux-Arts. I mean, not Beaux-Arts. It was
Bauhaus.
Bauhaus. And she was very good and likable.
Okay.
But we had all these visiting professors or visiting teachers from all over that came from Harvard mostly.
Mm-hmm.
They still do that when you were there?
Yeah.
Philip Johnson.
Yeah, we had that gang.
Paul Rudolph.
Paul Rudolph was fabulous.
Was he?
Mm. He was in charge of the Yale.
He was already at Yale.
When I was there, yeah.
Right.
And he was, you know, his architecture, I was, you know, captivated in those days with his.
Oh, he was hot.
But he was also a heck of a nice guy.
Was he really?
Oh, gosh. Mm-hmm. And he would come up in the middle of the night, you know, we would be working on charrette at 2 o'clock in the morning, and he'd come up, because he'd been working on his own, his career was rising fast. And he'd come over to the drafting board, and we'd have long talks.
Really? Late at night?
Yeah, and not him looking down, you know, together.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is a great...
What we were looking at and what he was looking at. And
really?
Very moving.
Did he talk about history or not so much? More about just what he saw in the drawings.
Nobody wanted to talk about history in those days. It was almost, it was more, you know, based on Lou's notion about what does a brick want to do.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's what it was about? Mm-hmm. Do you remember that, or was it not, that was before that? Did they talk about that?
Oh, no, that was basic.
Yeah. What does a brick want to be? What does
everybody.
The building want to be?
Yeah, we all read that.
Yeah.
So what were, what?
His idea, I mean, his quest was for, okay, this is a new material, concrete.
Right.
What is the appropriate expression of concrete?
Exactly.
Because it's just, you know.
It's new.
Mush, you know.
Yeah. Even though we've been using it for 100 years and the Romans used it
but,
a little bit
more. It was, you know, the avant-garde stuff, and that's why he wanted to express concrete with all his, you know, beaten-up concrete forms.
Tell me, what was Design Studio like on a normal studio day? What happened?
At your drawing board, the crit would walk around and look over what you did and talk about it and rip it apart.
Rip it apart.
Mostly, or suggest what's good about it. Or
That's what they draw.
Yeah, yeah. Well, not all of them, but
was tracing paper.
Jergla did a lot of drawing.
Oh, Jergla was good. Yeah.
And Kahn, I don't know if he did drawing on people's.
He was kind of a talker, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Or he loved to talk.
Yeah, he loved to talk.
And he
philosophized, isn't that right?
He loved to be silent for long periods of time too. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And everybody would wait for him.
Right.
Oh, really?
Oh my God!
Pregnant pauses. He loved that.
Oh,
he was a kind of an actor.
And everybody would.
He certainly would. Was
He was a presence.
The whole class would follow him around. You know, at the next table.
Is that right?
Going to crit somebody.
Yeah.
And
now, is that just true of Lou Kahn, or would that be true of all your critics that you'd follow them around?
Only Lou.
Oh, he was maestro.
He was very special. But others were, if you liked what they were saying.
You were allowed to follow around. See, my experience today is we don't do that. You talk to one student, it's a private tete-a-tete between you and the student. Not private, but it's tete-a-tete. The other kids could listen in. There's no following around. There's no... Were you allowed to ask questions? If you were following Lou around, could you ask him a question? Or no, he was doing all the talking.
You could if you had the courage.
Yeah. I would have been afraid.
Yeah.
Most of it would be rude.
If he came to your desk, so what did he say when he came to your desk?
Oh,
do you remember anything he said?
And, that's very interesting. You know, something like that, you know. And I ended up doing a bunch of columns that was supposed to, I can't remember the project, but I think it was a church or something like a church. And the approach was interesting and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. And what did he say?
He kind of ordered it for me, made it more orderly.
Okay.
And strength.
By drawing?
A little bit, you know, but mostly words.
Okay.
I think.
Mm-hmm. I think more words probably than drawing.
Did they ever tear drawings up or tear things apart or step on them or tell you jump in a lake?
No.
Not Lou. How about the other guys? No. Now, what about?
No, they were all gentlemen.
What about juries? You had pinups and juries. When did they happen?
Every 6 weeks or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm. When it was over.
Yeah.
So you didn't have like a pinup, intermediate pinup. You just had it at the end?
We didn't.
Just drew, he gave you crits every three times a week? How often did you see the teacher?
Yeah, three times, Monday, Wednesday, I think, wasn't it? But it varied by the teacher, how he could get there.
How about undergrads? How many would you have in one studio? With one teacher, I mean.
Well, that was beginning. Freshman class, there was, with Novitsky, was probably 40-something.
Mm-hmm.
And by the end of the year, boiled back down to, a bunch of people just dropped out.
Would you have one teacher per year, per year, or per semester, or would you have multiple teachers teaching at the same time, the sophomores or the juniors?
Oh, sophomores is when you really started to.
How many teachers would you have at one time?
Teaching That's when we had Gettysburg in the Falls and
Journal.
I don't remember him at the second year, but
third year? Who was in third year?
I'd have to look at that.
How about grad school? How many kids were in a class, in a studio, I mean, per teacher?
Well, that's the issue in those days. It was hard to tell who was in what program because they were all mixed up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I mean, there were some older guys in the class and some younger guys in the class.
Really?
And, you know, I came with 6 years behind me and
other people were starting out.
Second year, you know.
Right, okay.
So it was a mush. And I don't know. But in those days, yeah, you might have your favorite. Well, we were assigned, not critics, but what was the word? Not sponsors, but...
Yeah. It wasn't an atelier. But.
And 1 year, Gettys was my main mm-hmm. guy.
For the whole year?
For the whole year, yeah, mm-hmm. I think.
The only time I
was
had
just lucky.
The only time I had one person was a thesis.
Okay.
Last year.
Oh. Maybe Gettys was my thesis critic, maybe. But I did think we had advisors that we were assigned to earlier. But as I say, I was in a program that was kind of a little bit of this and a little bit of that.
What were the juries like? So you had the project happens, it's over in 6 weeks, you pin it up on the wall. What happened? What was the jury like?
Yeah, the varied by the personalities,
mm-hmm.
not only of the teachers, but the students. Like, a lot of the students were very articulate and charming and that sort of thing. That was good. It was entertaining.
He was very well because we were there a lot. I was never there in the mornings because I was... Because
we had other classes.
Credits. No, I had a little more credits that permitted me to work mornings in an office.
Oh, you work.
So I only was there in the afternoons.
Yeah, well, that's different. Yeah.
And it was a good, very, very good system for me.
See, I had to go to, I enjoyed going to mathematics and, you know, the nuts and bolts of building and literature and what else was there? But I had the impression that architects had to got a terrific education.
Why is that?
Because the everything was involved. You know, you did have sociology and psychology and health, and you know, you had to be able to understand and appreciate who your clients were going to be too.
Mm-hmm.
So. It was necessary that the architects be very well educated and understood everybody.
Mm-hmm.
That was the goal anyhow.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I took from the attitude from
the
teachers and these guys that were, I learned all from Harvard.
I think that was the general sense that I got too. Again, you had to know a lot of things about a lot of stuff
right. In
order to be a good architect. And mm-hmm. that still was carrying on this kind of Renaissance man kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. That was really important.
Was it an exciting time to be in architecture school? And what was the sense of the students? What was the time about the 50s, the early 60s? What was it? What did the students feel?
It was very exciting for me.
Why? Mm-hmm.
Well, because we had this great spiritual leader out there in the first place, Lou. Mm-hmm.
Right.
In the second place, University of Pennsylvania Planning Commission, the planning, you know, mm-hmm. department was tied into the Planning Commission of Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. And the relationship between the city and the university was really tight. And we had this dynamic head, what's his name, a Scotsman, at the head of the planning program, McHarg, Ian McHarg, which
was
really exciting, wonderful guy. and a real personality. And we had, what's his name, at the head of the planning commission?
Well,
Dynamite.
Perkins was the head of the planning commission for a while.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah. I think he...
But later on, it was, kind of Lou's arch rival. The guy that turned everything around
Ed
in
Bacon.
Philadelphia. Ed Bacon.
Yeah, he was an arch rival of Lou. Well,
Ed Bacon was the executive director.
Yeah.
I'm just talking about the commission. Planning commission, they were
Bacon,
the board of directors.
Yeah, Bacon was really strong.
But Bacon was terrific, yeah.
And Bacon had a very close relationship to Vincent Kling in the first place, and other architects. So, I mean, it's a very exciting time to be in Philadelphia.
Yeah, Penn was a happening place. So tell a little bit more about schoolwork. What kind of media did you use to produce drawings? And what were your tools, and what were you looking at? What were the tools you used? Were you using T-squares?
Yeah.
And what kind of media? Pencil, colored pencil?
Usually tracing paper was your presentation.
Really?
Because you were layering over different things.
So that already had started, the tracing paper revolution,
Yeah, and...
Well, yeah, tracing paper was used just before Rudolph took over at Yale.
Mm-hmm.
And the first year I was looking at things, I was still an undergraduate, but kids could get up with the darndest things in tracing paper and just talk their way through.
Oh yeah, they were good.
And at Yale.
And at Yale, but Penn too.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, they're still doing that.
And, but boy, when Rudolph took over, everything changed, bang, like that.
Inkle and Mylar? Or Inkle and whatever it was?
Well, on some
Strathmore.
Kind of paper.
Strathmore.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and
we had
he did
that,
enormous drawings, and then reduced them so they looked
even better.
Just delicate, they were amazing.
Mm-hmm. And did you do, what kinds of drawings did you do? Did you do plan sections, elevations? Did you do perspectives, axonometrics? What did you do?
Well, I certainly never did an axon in my life. I hated them.
Yeah. Did people do them?
But some people did them.
We were taught to do them.
Because
they were popular in those days.
Because
but
Drexler resisted. Claims in the MoMA exhibit of the Beaux-Arts, he claims that the axonometric is a tool of engineering, and it makes it objectifies the building and makes it into kind of a machine, and therefore certain modernists really liked it, as opposed to perspective, which gave you a person's vantage point.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm.
So you guys didn't do axons so much, though, in school?
No.
Not
for perspectives. Did they ask you to do perspectives?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we were taught all those things in my second year.
Now, what about the thing at I hear a lot about at UVA where I went to school, and then now at Notre Dame, we always get criticized for not doing models. Did you do models at Penn?
Definitely.
Yeah.
They did do models. Presentation models or study models?
Both.
Okay.
And it varied according to
the teacher asked you to do
teacher
stuff.
Teacher or the project or whatever.
And a study model. Now, when I was at Yale in the 80s, a study model meant you got out cardboard, pencil, and an X-Acto blade, and you started cutting. And that's how you designed your building. Did you do that, or did you first draw a plan section?
I drew first.
You first drew?
I think everybody drew first.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. This was the wildest thing at Yale, is that people would not draw, they would start cutting. They would draw on the cardboard and start cutting. So it was a very odd way to think about architecture. It was anti-plan.
Mm-hmm.
It was anti-plan. Was Penn, at that time, was plan still a focus, or was it facade? What was important?
I think plans ruled.
Yeah. Was the generator. Really. Plan was the generator.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And Lou Kahn always started with the plan.
Okay. And the reason was why? Why was the plan important to them? Function, or?
Because you could imagine the whole building at once. You see it all there.
Okay.
And you can imagine walking through it.
Right.
And imagining what it's going to look like.
Now, I have this fun...
I thought it was more... my impression was that it was more diagrammatic.
A plan was diagrammatic.
Well, to begin, I mean, you did that kind of
first.
The diagram of the functions, you know, and with Lou, it was servant spaces versus served spaces. Right.
And did you do
like that?
Did you guys all do servant versus served?
Oh, yeah, with Con. And with others, too.
And people bought into that idea.
Oh, everybody was,
And isn't that a modernist take on a Beaux-Arts idea or not? That's what Scully tries to argue, that it's a modernist reinterpretation of major spaces and poche spaces. Is that wrong?
Well, don't forget, Lou studied Beaux-Arts.
Right.
So yeah, but
probably
but
some connection.
I think the big difference is that there are only, I don't know who told me this, but I've been uttering it ever since. There are only three or four basic plan arrangements. Mm-hmm. Only three or four basic facades. You know, you've either got one bay, three bays, or five bays. You know, I mean, there's some fundamental plan types and elevation types. And, you know, you don't have to turn yourself upside down and in and out to try to find something that doesn't conform to those fundamentals.
Yeah, there's a book like that that has all these different
What he
proposed that, like you just said, there's only so many things you could do, and these are them.
Start with that, and then, So the server versus
the Beaux-Arts system, as I recall, as I was told, is that you're given a project, a type, whether it's a library or a school or whatever, and then you have a certain amount of time to examine libraries, you know, or schools or something like that, you know, to get prototypes. And that's when you are put into a little room, you know, and given 4 hours to do your esquisse.
And was there any emphasis on esquisse, something like an esquisse, or had that been already kind of gotten rid of?
No, we always had that. I mean, not always.
Oh, we never, absolutely, we never had it.
We had it every, sort of once a year was a sort of a game or a party or a special, you know, it was.
A little design project?
We had a charrette.
A one-day charrette?
One day and night.
Yeah.
And then with the crits coming the next day.
So it was like those Rougevin prizes, those Beaux-Arts prizes, continued, those one-day things.
That was gone by the time
By 1960, that was gone.
That's interesting.
So, so this is actually how some of us teach at Notre Dame, and it's great fun. Students often don't like it. But, you know, one of my favorite quotes is our friend John Harbison, who worked in the office, or who's the partner of Paul Cray. And this is a great quote from 1961, Philadelphia chapter, American Institute of Architects. I want your thoughts on this. He says, for years after 1940, the library was deserted except by the students of the history of architecture. Architects used only current periodicals or the monographs of works of the prophets of the new dispensation. Mm-hmm. But recently, there has come some exciting news. Lou Kahn, professor of architectural design at the University of Pennsylvania, is now taking his students into the library, showing them the beauty in and the inspiration to be had from Letarouille, Grandjean de Montaigne, Stewart and Rivette, and the other records of great work. This is a heartening note. Students will again have the opportunity to broaden their minds by learning something of the great works of the past. Did you experience that? Did Lou take you into the library?
Who wrote that?
This is John Harbison, 1961.
Well, he did with us.
61?
Kahn took you in and showed you books.
Yeah.
In the library.
Right. So did Jurgelin.
Really? Do you remember what the books were? Did any that struck you?
Like, offhand, I think.
Did you, were some of them things like Renaissance?
Drawings were he liked, too. The
okay.
Old, didn't he get a Rome Prize?
He did. He went to the American Academy. He didn't get the Rome Prize, but he went to the American Academy in, was it 54, something like that?
Paul.
Lou Kahn.
Oh, Lou. Really?
Yeah, he was at the American Academy for a while. That's where he started drawing those famous drawings of the ruins, of the walls, and so on.
But when he was a student, I'm talking about, he got something.
Okay, it could be.
I don't know what it was.
I don't remember.
But because he was showing, I thought it was his drawing. It might not have been, but it was a Beaux-Arts type of a drawing.
He showed you that. And why would he show that to you?
Because it was beautiful. And I guess, like you say, there were servant buildings, servant spaces and spaces in the servants.
Served and servants, yeah.
Yeah.
So, but Al, you didn't experience this from Lou, taking you to see old
books. No, and it's always astonished me that people do talk about Lou's classical origins. And yikes, I never got a whiff of that.
Yeah, you didn't get a whiff of it. You had him for like a year at Yale?
Well, I saw him a lot at Yale.
You saw him a lot at Yale, and then...
And then at Penn.
And then you were at 2 years. And you had him for a whole year at Penn, or you were just around at Penn?
He was in and out.
He was in and out.
Yeah.
And he didn't take you to the library?
Oh, gosh, no.
See, that's so interesting, isn't it?
Didn't he talk about library books? I mean, old books or studies or
drawings?
No, old drawings?
As a matter of fact, I got an entirely different... When I got to Penn, I was told by somebody about the day that Perkins took over and eradicated the books. I mean, literally, all the big books, the big folios
right.
I've got all over the place here, and they were put into dumpsters and taken down to
they really were thrown away?
And they were absolutely thrown away.
Because they're verboten.
I can't believe that.
Fahrenheit 451, we need to destroy the books.
Right.
Censorship, like the Nazis.
Yeah, well, there are opinions on this. You know, they say, I mean, many people say, oh, come on, don't, you didn't believe that. But...
Huh.
I believe
symbolically, he might have done that, but he wouldn't have destroyed.
Well, this is what Harbison says, though. He says for years the library was deserted.
Mm-hmm.
So, but you remember with Kahn being taken down to the library to see books. Now, is it true?
And he when he was talking to me or other people, and he'd say, "Go and see such
really?
And such a book,
okay,
and look at this project of so and so."
Really.
And it's on about page something. Or
no way, really? But no, these were not necessarily just modern architecture.
No, old stuff. Yeah.
See, that's so interesting. Now, I had the most schizophrenic experience at the University of Virginia in 1980s that they would tell you to look at two things. They tell you to look at Le Tarawi, Architecture Moderne of the Renaissance in Rome, or they'd have you look at the Oeuvre Complète. Le Corbusier's volume set. So we were looking at Le Corbusier or Great Roman Palaces. And we were supposed to somehow put them together. But the point was we were supposed to look at the library. And that was a good thing.
Yeah.
And you could look at different stuff. So anyway, okay, so this... so
Well, we always had... I mean, the classes had handouts when they began, and they always had a references of books. And sometimes they were... older books, but most of the time it was
modern books.
It was just the books that would have examples.
How about the magazines, though? Is it true? This is what Harbison says, that for years students were just looking at periodicals or monographs of modern architects.
Probably.
Who were you guys looking at the time? What books were you looking at when you were in school?
Those that were published.
Do you remember what were your favorite books that you referred to help you design?
Progressive Architecture, was it?
Or magazines.
Yeah, and the Record, and
The magazines.
The monthly magazines.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you looked at that a lot.
Yeah, they all of them.
I didn't look at any books.
That's what everybody looked at, was the magazines.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that was a given. You had to see what was news.
I remember being shocked in school that people were looking at magazines, and that's how they got their ideas. And I realized that's how everybody did, cool, up-to-date stuff, whereas I thought we were supposed to look at books. Dead architects.
Mm.
And I still think
I think it'd be an interesting thing to chase down this idea that all the books were taken out and dumped and burned. I mean, literally burned in the incinerators. I mean, not ceremonially, but in the incinerators down on Delaware.
But don't they still have at the Penn Library, don't they have lots of great folios?
No.
Penn does not have great folios?
Well,
it must have been 1920.
Perkins got rid of all that stuff.
Wow.
And he retired, and he had a position, he had a main in place there in the new building, in and an enormous library, and he was rebuilding that library, and that's why he was bidding against me at the deaccession.
Who was this? Who did this?
Perkins.
Even though he had destroyed it before?
Yeah.
Why? He sold the error of his ways?
No, he sold all the books, probably.
That makes sense.
You mean he bought them and sold them? No, he wanted to put them up in the, you know, in this 18-foot ceiling office that he had.
Oh, for himself?
Well,
memorial.
It was a pen.
It was a memorial space.
But maybe, I don't know whether he was recanting, but it would be interesting to chase that story down, because I got it as gospel, and many people have corroborated it.
Is there a book?
And then to see him, you know, restocking the library that he had eliminated.
Well, it's fairly fairly well cited that the dean at Harvard at the time,
who was what's his name?
The Bauhaus.
The guy who brought Gropius in.
Gropius.
Oh. No, it was the guy who brought Gropius in. He. I thought it was him, but it could have been Gropius, that they worked to close the library to the architecture students, to not allow them to look at old stuff, because that would poison you and lead you astray and so on. So you go to Penn, you go to Yale, you go to Penn, you study with Lou. There's not much books, but Dad says he has a little bit of experience of the books in Lou. You get out and you go to work. What's your first job? Who are the hot architects in Philadelphia, and who do you get to work for?
I worked with Ron Turner when I was at Penn. I worked for him in the morning, Donald C. Turner, and liked it a lot. He was a modernist, and I did very nice things with him. And he was. And then I worked for John Bauer, and it is now Bauer Lewis Thrower.
Oh yeah,
and John, it was Bauer and Fradley at the time.
He was my counselor.
And, yeah, John was very, very nice fella at Penn, teacher when I was there, and he was a graduate of Vincent Kling. So, next stop was Vincent Kling, and I was there 10 years, and I loved pretty much every minute of it, and did very modern things that I'm very happy with.
You're happy with them?
Very happy, yeah. Hospitals, two hospitals, and huge University of Connecticut Health Center. Enormous thing. I mean, the kind of thing that a young man would never get to do if he
were
working for a guy like Kling. And it was fabulous for me.
Wow.
And then a smaller hospital, St. Mary Hospital out in Bucks County. Very happy with that. And some schools. I was completely happy. A couple factories. Yeah.
Okay, Dad, how about you? What was your first jobs?
I think it was a summer job with...
These were not first jobs for me. Those were last jobs before I
left. A couple of jobs. Yeah, a couple of jobs.
But I worked for... Maybe I already get them. But he did the... he was... did all of Bell telephone work. Fletcher. Something Fletcher. So the mainline person, architect, who I think had horses, or his daughter had horses, and, you know, that type of thing. But he always had to go out lunch with the Bell telephone people of one sort or another. And so he did a lot of their buildings and vaults. I remember technically just to keep them from, they were practically bomb proof, you know,
right,
to keep the
right
communications going. And the interesting project that we did was two of them. One was an office building right across from City Hall, the new City Hall annex, and behind that Bell telephone office building. And it was all stainless steel, panels on the outside, and it had an interesting in the lobby, the high ceilings, like a 20-foot ceiling or something like that. They had the chilled water in the ceiling, and this was very unusual.
To try to cool the building,
right? And
interesting.
So they built it as I really didn't follow that up to see how that worked out, but I'd never heard about it.
So Fletcher,
did you ever do a building with
no,
chilled
idea.
Water in the ceiling, because the heat rises and then it chills it off?
It makes sense.
And then it drops.
Yeah, so this was supposed to be like the natural way to cool.
But very expensive, turned out to be.
I'm sure it was, but they didn't care about expense.
In those days, right. Expense and energy.
In that office, anyhow. So that was kind of fun.
Who else? Fletcher?
Oh, wait. Actually, I think we did that. It. Tubes of chilled water above the...
It's a metal.
The hung ceiling.
Metal ceiling, yeah.
Oh.
The hung metal panels.
We did this at... at the hospital in Bucks County, and we felt it worked very well because the people who really needed were all horizontal at the same place.
That's right.
It didn't hit the floor or other parts. I mean, you could stand here, you know, and you'd be in different zones.
Right.
But it worked especially well for hospitals where everybody is on the same.
Just don't move.
But I think we're talking about a similar thing.
And I have an interesting article for you, just for fun. It's no big deal, but it's an article by Harbison on Paul Cray and the number of competitions he entered. He entered some outrageous number of competitions, which you probably would be sympathetic with, because you've done a lot of competitions.
No, I haven't.
No?
No.
Okay, he entered so many competitions, and Harbison goes through them all, and which ones he won, which ones he placed but never were built, which ones he didn't place in, which ones he came in second. You know, it's a great little fun article.
No, I've never entered one willingly.
The
thing you saw out there, where that was an invitational thing and we were paid.
Okay, well, that's even better, though.
Well, but I don't compete, basically.
Right. So just tell us a couple of these firms. Fletcher...
Jurgala. It's called Mitchell Jurgala.
That was a beautiful office for a while.
Yeah. That's a place where they built models all the time.
Okay.
Yeah, and they had a big room just for models.
Beautiful reputation, a nice camaraderie. And
yeah, they were.
Apparently not a lot of competition because Aldo and
Mitchell.
Mitch were a nice balance.
Really?
Somehow.
That's great.
Mitchell took care of the
very
business.
Very different personalities.
Right.
And Aldo was.
But it was.
Sounds like Johnson and Bergie. They were evidently
probably
a good.
Yeah.
A good balance.
It was
they
a
were different guys.
Office. Everybody I've known.
Oh, really?
Loved it, and I knew both of them, and it's. Yeah. Wonderful office.
So who were?
I'm not crazy about a lot of the work they did.
No.
But gee, what a.
But a nice place to work.
Exemplary environment.
What other offices, Dad?
Frank Vitetta, which is a breakaway from. It's the engineers, big engineering firm in Philadelphia. I think my wife worked for them for a while. Engineer.
Okay.
But anyhow,
Frank
Vitetta was the architect.
Right.
He did a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I worked on the train stations for suburban New York to Connecticut line there.
Yeah, what's the other name of Vitetta?
They do have probably another name. There's a good guy I worked with who was
thought he just died.
Vitetta died?
No, but the partner.
The other partner. Yeah, something in Vitetta.
Vitetta.
Now it's like the Vitetta group.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a young guy I worked with there who did some alterations at the National Gallery of Art.
Yeah. Who did that?
With, he you did know, the with circle. The circle. Yeah.
In the lobby of the National Gallery of Art.
And
I thought that was Frank Vitetta.
Yeah. Well, it was that guy.
Yeah, he had kind of a classical sensibility.
He was
historical sensibility.
He was brilliant.
He put the Oculus in the lobby when you come in on the Constitution Avenue, and they actually added the Oculus. This is the guy we're talking about. Yeah,
I could look it up.
He just died.
No,
okay,
really? Last week. I think.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
He must be pretty up there.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
He was a brilliant guy. So.
Yeah, he had a good sensibility. He copied the moldings. It all looks like.
Yeah, that's a nice job.
It all looks like Pope would have done it, even though the people that love Pope say no, Pope would have never done that. But
no, but it's a good.
He
job.
He did it in the way that it would. If Pope wanted to have an opening there, he would have done it that way. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've always liked it.
With that,
You know, Same marble and all that.
I was impressed with him as a boss, too.
Really? He was your boss?
Yeah, he treated everybody exceptionally well. And although at the same time, you knew how smart he was.
Was it? Is that who it was? Hyman Myers?
Hyman Myers, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that wasn't the partner. He, I was hired.
Mm-hmm.
He achieved a very high status, and he's retired now.
Mm-hmm.
I see him once in a while. But that's not the name we're looking for.
No? Okay. No.
Well, that's the one I was thinking of. That's a
you
guy
worked
I worked
for Hyman Myers.
Hyman Myers was my boss.
And then who else did you work for?
Francis Kaufman Pepper or something like that.
Francis Kaufman Pepper.
Yeah.
Worked
them for a little while. Dan Zimmerman. That's our engineers. Dan and Zimmerman were engineers.
Right.
And Vitetta broke away from Dan and Zimmerman.
Okay.
Or I think the way it worked, he talked Dan Zimmerman into financing his
architecture firm
build up because he got a bunch of projects. And he was a good salesman.
Yeah, Dan Z. Yeah.
A very important one was Carol Grisdale and Van Allen.
Oh yeah, that's a good one.
I worked there for a couple years. And then they got slow and they got me a job at H2L2.
Oh really? That was nice.
Yeah. So I just moved over there. And one of the guys at Carol Grisdale and Van Allen worked for the Planning Commission also. And then he moved to Reston and did the planning with Conklin Rosen.
Oh really?
For Reston.
Who did that?
Forgotten his name now. Let's see.
He was somebody at
Irv Wasserman. Irv Wasserman. There's a couple others. I've only worked in Philadelphia for 15 years or so, I think. Was it 58?
But this young man,
72.
You didn't work here very long before you started your own place, did
14
you?
Years.
How about you? Al?
Well, I started working in 1960 for Ron Turner when I was still going to school.
Right.
And I started my own firm in 76.
Yeah, so just a little bit longer.
Mm-hmm.
But
I guess,
you started your own firm in 76, you left in 72?
Mm-hmm.
72,
and I went to work as a research architect.
Hmm.
Sounds good. But that was at the National Bureau of Standards. They had a architecture section there under the standards.
Hmm.
All right.
We're 7 minutes late, but we're on our way.
Oh, okay.
Don't give it away.
Where are we going?